Okay, good morning everybody. I'll continue with the next talk, and Aldo already gave the very large title of this presentation. We looked at the efficacy of Malaysia vaccine against the A-Asian G7 limit, and I want to start with saying that it is a collaborative project. This is a project from the WBVR in Lelystad, together with the colleagues from Purbright and the colleagues from Australia. And I think it's a nice example what you can do if you combine your resources and have a similar aim for research. So this introduction I can maybe skip, because it was already pointed out by Hélène and also by Don in the first day. But in 2015 there was a new emerging strain, and it came from the Indian subcontinent, and it spread quite fast in the western direction. And there was evidence from the field that the vaccines that were being used in those countries gave poor protection because it spread so fast. And this was supported by in vitro vaccine matching data of the WRL. They did cross-neutralization tests, and they established R1 values for this new strain against the vaccine strains that were being used in that region. And I think it was already explained earlier by Alejandra that these R1 values, they have a cutoff level. So if the R1 value is 1, the field strain is similar to the vaccine strain, the protection is okay, and the lower the R1 value gets, the less protection is being expected. And the cutoff level is 0.3. And all the vaccines that were tested, so A Saudi 95, A 22 Iraq, and A Iran 05, they had a very low R1 value against A Asia G7. So these new emerging strains that appear all the time, it's a problem for the countries that have FMD in their countries in which it is endemic, but it's also actually a problem for the countries that are free, because we want to stay free of the disease, and we, to do that, we have our antigen vaccine banks, and we have antigens stored in that, and we want to be sure that the antigens that are in that bank will protect against new emerging strains. So is all lost then? No, because we know that if vaccines have a low R1 value, there might be protection, and this was also shown by the group of Bernd Haas, and I think Mariano said yesterday was the fourth time he showed this paper, and then I will be the fifth to show this paper. But there might be a heterologous protection from vaccines with a low R1 value, as long as you use a high potent vaccine. So this urges us to see if maybe the vaccines that we have were good enough. And like I said, the FMD-free countries rely on vaccine banks, and the people from Purbright, the UK, they rely on the European Vaccine Bank. Australia has their own national vaccine bank, and also we in the Netherlands, from history, we have our own national vaccine bank. And the antigens that are stored in these banks are not necessarily the same, but we started this project to see if the type A vaccines that we did have were efficacious against A-Asia G7. And the antigens that we had in the banks, and not all the same in all banks, but the number of antigens that we had were A Iran 05, A Saudi 95, A Malaysia 97, and A 22 Iraq. So Also, other people saw this problem and started working on a solution. And also another collaborative project, they started looking if a multivalent vaccine that contained A Saudi 95 and A Iran 05 protected against A Asia G7. And they did a PPG test. And it turned out that this vaccine protected not good enough against this strain. So then we decided we would stay away from testing A Saudi 95 and A Iran 05 and start testing the other two antigens that we had in our bank. So we started with a pilot study in which we used the vaccines A22 Iraq and A Malaysia. And we did a study with seven animals in each group, and we used full dose vaccines and just see if they were protected against A-Asia G7. And it turned out that the A22 Iraq vaccinated animals were poorly protected, and the A-Malaysia 97 vaccinated animals were at least a number of them, roughly 70%, were protected against against this ease. So A Malaysia 97 gave clinically the best results, and also we could see that the virus shedding in the mouth swabs was reduced. And I want to point out that also in this study and also other studies that we did, there was a very good correlation between the VNT titers and protection, because I noticed in earlier talks that there is a lot of discussion about animals with high titers that are not protected, animals with low titers that are protected, and these things do occur, but still, in general, the VNT titer is a very good predictive thing for protection against disease. So in this pilot study, the A-Malaysia vaccine gave 72% protection, and we decided to go on with that specific antigen. So we decided that we would do a full PD50, in which we used 17 animals, and we looked at the clinical protection, which is the normal readout parameter in a PD50 study. But we also did some more sampling so that we could also look at the virus excretion between the groups. And of course, we looked at the serological responses. And we did use a normal PD50. Usually, what is used is a full dose, one 4-dose and one 16-dose. But because we expected that we might have not very good protection, we shifted a little bit to 1/3 and 1/9 dose to be able to calculate correct PD50, because you need protected animals for the calculation. Otherwise, you end up with a huge confidence interval. We challenged with a virus from the A-Asia G7 lineage, and the challenge was done by tongue inoculation, which is the common method in a PD50 study. So I don't have a pointer, so I want to guide you through this table by words, I hope. These are all the results. So on the left-hand side, you see the cow numbers, which are divided in the full dose, 1/3, 1/9, and dose and control animals. And then the column, the first column with results on the left-hand side, it summarizes the foot lesions. And as you can see, there were very little animals with foot lesions. All the animals with the full dose, they were fully protected. There was one animal in the 1/3 dose that had lesions, and only three animals in the 1/9 dose group that were that showed foot lesions. And all the controls went down with disease. We also looked at the serum samples to see if we could see any viremia. And in the virus isolation test, so that's the column next to the foot lesions, we could detect no virus. So there was no viremia observed at all in all the vaccinated animals. So in the PCR, we could detect some RNA, but this was in the animals with foot lesions. There were was virus in the nose and mouth swabs that we collected because we wanted to quantify the virus excretion, but that is because of the challenge method. And this is a picture taken in the stables, and it's a very, very obvious sign in cattle that we infected by tongue inoculation. They have this tongue, it's full of vesicles, and this is what we see in the stable. They really salivate a lot, so it's really logical that we find virus in the mouth and the nose region. It's just a consequence of the challenge method. So with the clinical results, we could calculate the PD50, and it turned out that actually this vaccine had a very good PD50. That's 6.5 PD50 per dose. And from the virus isolation data, we could show that the full dose and the one-third dose groups, they performed significantly better as compared to the control group in terms of the amount of virus that was shed and also the duration of virus shedding. Then we have the VNT results. We did the VNT against the vaccine strain and against the field strain. And for the, you can see that the VNT titers against the vaccine strain, they're quite high. So they're 2.2 in the full dose and a little lower in the other groups, and they were 1.4 for against the field strain. And there was, again, very good correlation between VN titer and protection. So the conclusion is that a high-potent achromatin vaccine can protect against heterologous challenge with the AAsia G7 strain, even though the in vitro results predicted a poor antigenic match. However, this is probably highly dependent on the quality and potency of the used vaccine. And as Helene showed, the pharmaceutical industry is always busy. But so now we have also an AAsia G7 vaccine available. And in fact, with the result of this study, our British colleagues and Australian colleagues, they were very happy because they had the achromatin antigen in their vaccine banks. In the Netherlands, we do not have it. So now we have to advise our ministry. And what would be our advice to implement the achromatin or to implement the AAsia G7? And then also these questions were asked this morning. The question is, does AAsia protect against other type A strains? Because the vaccine banks that we have, you cannot build these on endlessly. They're very costly. So if we take one vaccine in, another one has to be kicked out. And we want to be sure that the overall coverage stays good against everything. So work is never done. So we have new questions, but finally, what we would like to know is if there is a relation between the heterologous and homologous potency of a vaccine. And in an ideal world, we would very much be able to predict the heterologous potency if we know the homologous potency. Sorry, yeah, it's a large slide, yeah. So this is the graph that Aldo made, and the blue line is the homologous potency of the vaccine, the red line is the heterologous potency, and so you see here there must be a relation between the homologous and the heterologous potency. So what we would like to do is, maybe build a model in which we have the information of the vaccine, so the homologous potency, and then the relation with might be an R1 value or might be the avidity or a combination of things so that in future we can predict the potency or the if a vaccine will be of use in the field, because we cannot test them all. So I'd like to thank all the collaborators, and there's no time for questions.
Now we have